Thank you, Coach, for joining us again this week. Starting off, Mike King got back on track with a complete game on Sunday to win the series against Virginia Tech. Can you talk about his adjustments to get back to the pitcher he had been a few weeks ago?
Yeah, it was great to see Mike being Mike again. I think one of the first things that jumped out at you watching him was the fastball down the zone, fastball command down in the zone with the sink that we're used to, and just ground ball after ground ball after ground ball, which was that's what we're used to with Mike. In the last couple of weeks, he'd fastball started to drift up in the zone a touch, and even his outs were getting more outs in the air than we're used to with him. So that was kind of the first thing that jumped out at you. And we were maybe sixth or seventh inning. I was joking with Coach Murphy in the dugout that it's fun playing defense behind Mike King in the infield because you know you're going to get a bunch of action.
We know how Mike played, but Justin Dunn was also dominant again this weekend on Saturday. What has his development been to make him a starter as he was a closer to start the year? Can you talk about that switchover and what he's done to be able to get into that role?
Yeah, Coach Foster's done an unbelievable job with all these guys, but specifically you're talking about Justin. As a closer, he was kind of going more with two, maybe three pitches. He didn't throw a changeup a ton. He's really started using the changeup more in the starting role. Sometimes when he was closing, he got to throwing a little bit instead of backing off and pitching. And he's showing how he can do that, with his fastball command, with being able to use four pitches, being able to control runners, doing all those things that sometimes in one-inning stints you don't have to do. So that's kind of the first thing that you see. And then also just, I was taking a couple of weeks to build him out. We kept his pitch count fairly low the first couple of weeks. He got to 111. I think he was 111 this weekend, which is, it was really one batter more than I would have liked. We just really liked the matchup, and he had two outs in the inning, and we sort of knew he was tired and kind of wanted to give him that one more guy to get himself out of that inning. And so we were thinking really 100 to 105 was where we wanted him. And but as far as what he's done, getting his body ready, getting his arm ready, he's done an unbelievable job.
Offensively, Nick Sciortino and Johnny Adams have seemed to heat up at the plate lately. They've always been defensive forces, but what do you think their hot bats can do to help this team, and what have they done so far this season?
Yeah, it's not surprising. Both those guys got off to some slow starts. There was never any real doubt whether or not they were going to hit this year. It's just a matter of sort of when it was going to come. And guys like that that have proven they can do it, that are very good players, that we all believe in, you just sort of keep letting them get their at-bats and let those numbers even out. And that's what they're doing with both those guys. Scores consistently gives us good at-bats. Johnny, even early in the year when he was scuffling a touch, always seemed to have a knack for driving in a run or getting a big hit in a big spot. He's a baseball player. That's what he does. But watching those two guys now, they're having a huge impact on our offense.
The Eagles have now won four ACC series, tie-in for the most since BC joined the ACC back in 2006, the baseball season 2006. What does this mean for the development and progression of the program?
Yeah, it's great. That's what you're trying to do every weekend is go out and win a series. And it's nice to talk about that, but it really, what we're talking about is playing in postseason. So, it is a good step in the development. And, there's a lot of sort of signs, as we're seeing, as this program develops and keeps getting better and better. But, we're really not in a spot where we want to sit and talk about being happy winning one series or two series or three series, right? We want to talk about the series that we want to talk about is winning two out of three in a super regional. And when we start talking about winning that series, then we'll start being happy and excited. But right now we're focused on, URI today and Northeastern tomorrow, and then, very good Wake Forest team coming in this weekend.
On Saturday at the fifth annual ALS awareness game, BC will retire Pete Frates' number three jersey. Can you talk about what Pete means to the baseball program and what went into the decision to retire his number?
Yeah, I don't think I can fully do justice for what Pete means to this team, this program. you know, me personally, you know, this university, it's hard to really put into words. The best way, all you have to really do is watch the look on our boys' faces on Saturday when Pete shows up and comes out in the field. Or if you could have been there when I told the boys what we were going to do and to see some of their reactions, especially the juniors and seniors. Not the freshmen and sophomores don't love Pete, but the juniors and seniors grew up with Pete. He was with us on every road trip for those guys early in their career. So, you know, Pete and John and Nancy and Andrew and Julie and Lucy, like, they're family. And what went into the decision, to me, it's a pretty easy decision. You know, Pete texted me afterwards joking, said something about being a 240 career hitter, but that doesn't even come close to showing the impact he's had on the program. And you look at, you know, the two people that really have had the most impact in the history of our program, Coach Pellegrini and Pete Frates, right? So why wouldn't both of those guys have their names and numbers up on our fence? And has nothing to do with getting a hit or getting an out. It's those guys showing us what it means to play baseball here and what type of a person and character and what are our values as a program. And, you know, so that's why we're so excited to have Pete and the whole freight train out there on Saturday.
Coach, just a few more questions about Pete. What was your personal reaction to the decision when you heard his jersey was going to be retired?
I was excited. It was something we'd talked about and kind of, you know, I don't want to say fought for because it didn't really get a lot of pushback, but it was something that we had talked about last year and thought about maybe doing last year. So as far as a personal reaction, I was excited. You know, this thing all goes back to really one thing, and it's, you know, Pete's reaction when he, you know, when he got his diagnosis was, all right, here we go, let's fight. You know, nothing was about him. It was, what can we do to end this disease? And you've probably heard me say it a million times, but Pete gave us the directive, raise money, raise awareness. It's unacceptable that ALS, that we haven't made any strides as far as treatment, prevention, cure since Lou Gehrig, right? So, you know, it goes back to that first meeting with Pete and John, you know, four marches ago, this is where we're going. So, you know, my personal reaction is this is cool and this is fun and it's a great honor for Pete, but the goal is I don't want to have any more ALS games. That's the goal, right? We want our kids to talk about ALS the way we talk about polio.
Yeah, you mentioned previous ALS games. Is there a reason you'd choose to retire the jersey on Saturday instead of previous ALS games early in the year or earlier seasons?
No, I think there was just, you know, I don't think there's any specific reason. We had talked about it a little bit last year. And I think there was other things that we sort of wanted to do with ALS Day and other things that we're still building, that we're still working on. I think the timing just seemed really right this year. You know, so I don't think there's any specific reason why this year instead of last year. It's just something we had talked about and thought about and it's, like I said, seemed like the right time.
Can you talk a little bit about the success of the Wounded Warrior Project game last weekend?
Yeah, it's that's an amazing weekend, starting on Thursday, and to see, one of the cool things is so many of the people that play in that softball game, there's sort of two groups of people that are coming to that softball game every year. You know, there's maybe 5 to 10 that are there every year that our guys get to know and that are becoming, building friendships. So it's a little bit of almost a reunion. You know, it's, you know, somebody like Ryan Cassavant, who works for Wounded Warrior Project and Project Odyssey, you know, our boys that we come up, they're like, hey, is Ryan coming this year? They're, you know, they get fired up to see him, and he's just one example. So the guys that come back every year, it's like family. And then the other part is people that have a chance, you know, veterans and Wounded Warriors have a chance to come out and be involved in it the first time. And, you know, if we can do something small to help them and honor them and, you know, the way that our boys look and honor and revere these veterans is real. And I think one of the fun things for me is watching my boys interact with the veterans and the people from the Wounded Warrior Project. And it's they are a special group of people that have done so much for our country. And I think it's also, we're doing something for them, but I don't know if you've ever heard the old line, when you give something, you get something back twice in return. And, we're out there doing something for the veterans, for our military, trying to honor them. But our boys get so much out of that, that it's a really fun day to watch. And then Saturday is great to have them all out there. And, the silly things like the big flag and the stuff before that that's just, it's just fun. It's fun to talk about how much we love our country and how much we love our veterans, and it's very much at the core of our program. Respect our flag, love our country, and revere our military.
You mentioned how Pete and his family have been traveling with the team, or had been for at least some of the juniors and seniors. Are there any of the older guys who have grown particularly close to Pete and his family over his time here?
Yeah, I think one of the first ones is, who's not with us this year, but Chris Shaw, who. His relationship with Pete goes back to high school. They played on a summer league team back when Chris was a sophomore. Chris and Pete are still in contact all the time. Pete's a large part of Chris ending up here. He's very much a role model. One of Chris's goals is Chris is going to try to always have a three, whatever number he wears going through the minor leagues, and he wants to always try to have a three in that number to honor Pete, which is an amazing thing. And he's just one example. I mean, all these guys are in contact with him, Joey and Luke and Bobby. And these guys are talking to Pete all the time. They're talking about Pete all the time. They're, half the time, a lot of times on the road, on the bus, these guys are sending videos to Pete through Facebook before a game, after a win, checking in with him. It's just he's constantly, even though he's not traveling with us now, he's very much as much a part of this program as any of our staff members that are traveling. So it's hard to pick one or two guys that have that relationship with him. And honestly, it's filtering down. I mean, I had a conversation last night with one of our recruits from New Hampshire that with this band together to strike out ALS and the wristbands that are being worn throughout college baseball this month, and he wants to do it with his high school team, and it's starting to spread throughout high school teams in New England. And you talk about a kid that's not yet in the program but is already part of the Birdball family, and now he's jumping on board the freight train. So it's even the kids that haven't been around Pete, it's part of who we are now.
Looking ahead to Wake Forest, would you call this weekend a must-win series if you guys want to remain in the playoff picture?
Yeah, honestly, it's hard. You look at 30 games in the ACC, every game's a must-win because you have no clue how the whole thing is going to play out. You look at our conference right now, I think it's 7 or 8 teams are within a game of each other, right in the middle. So you could look at this like a must-win, but you have no clue how those other series are going to play out, right? You could win 3 games this weekend and not move at all in the standings based on some other teams, and you could lose 3 games and not move. When you're talking about 14 teams, 14 really good quality teams, you're talking about, 7 or 8 teams fighting for those. It looks like there's about 3 or 4 teams that are somewhat settled into the playoff spots, and the rest of us are just fighting and scrapping to get those last spots. It's like it's too hard to figure out to do the math of how many wins you're going to need and who's going to. So is Friday a must win? Yeah, but no more important than last Friday or the Friday before that. They're all kind of must wins. So, what's our goal is let's just worry about winning one baseball game on Friday. And then after that game, regroup, and whether it's a win or a loss, worry about winning one baseball game on Saturday. And it sounds like coach speak and cliche, but it's not. It's just how you handle it. And then after the weekend, pick your head up and, kind of see where you are and forget what you have to do. Because other than that, it's too hard to figure out all the math.